So, the title of this presentation is the local field potential, often called the LFP. So, what is the LFP? Well, there are many ways to measure brain activity. In particular, there are many ways to measure electrical brain activity. Neurons in, say, cortex, when they are active, having action potentials and sending synaptic inputs to each other, they generate electrical signals that can be recorded by electrodes on the outside. And if you put the electrode on the scalp, that's called an EEG recording. If you put it on the cortical surface, it's called an echo recording. Or if you have an electrode inside the population, you can measure something called the spikes, but also what's called the local field potential. And the same bunch of active neurons also sets up magnetic fields that can be measured outside the head with this MEG recordings. So the typical analysis of these extracellular recordings inside the brain has been to do this band filtering into a high frequency band and a low frequency band. And the high frequency band, maybe about like a few hundred hertz, 500 hertz maybe, is sometimes called a multi-unit activity, because this measure spikes in the individual neurons around the electrode tip. And I would say most of the measurements and maybe the insights we have gotten from measuring in vivo brains in vivo has been from measuring and interpreting spikes. And the low frequency band, though, it's called the local field potential, has more power. Often it has been, traditionally it was almost, discarded. It wasn't even stored, partially because it didn't have cheap, large hard disks, but also because it was more difficult to interpret. Because it measures sub-threshold activity due to synaptic inputs from populations of neurons. So you cannot just look at the signal and say, well, this sort of bump comes from this particular synaptic input. You have to do a little bit more prior analysis to interpret it in terms of neuronal activity. However, a good thing is that we know the link between the activity in neurons and these extracellularly recorded potentials. And the link goes via the transmembrane currents of the neuron. So often when you simulate neural activity, you're interested in the membrane potential in the soma, because that's where it's sort of decided whether this neuron generates an action potential or not. When you do these kind of simulations, you also, as a sort of a side product, you get out all these transmembrane currents in these different parts of the neuron, different compartments. And if you know these, or if you have computed these, then you can compute the potential recorded at any extracellular position in the brain. So for the simplest case where there's it's like an infinite homogeneous volume conductor, that's a volume conductor where this extracellular conductivity can be assumed to be the same everywhere and also the same in all directions. And this actually turns out to be a quite good approximation even inside the cortex, even though there's lots of of course outside in this extracellular space is very convolved and so on. To a good approximation, this signal propagation inside cortex can be modeled with a single value of this material parameter sigma, the extracellular conductivity. This is the formula for the simplest situation, but you can also quite easily generalize this to situations where this extracellular conductivity is not constant. For example, when the signal propagates from a neuron up to the electrode and an EEG electrode and the top of the scalp, where it has to go through like skin and skull and all kinds of material with different extracellular connectivities. So this, I would say, this link between neural activity or the transmembrane currents and the extracellular potential you measure is quite well established. And it can be a, it applies to all signals, both spikes and LFPs and EEGs and ECOGs and so on. So that's good news from a modeling perspective. So, but the interpretation of the LFP is a bit more, as I mentioned, a bit more complicated than for spikes, which is the extracellular signature of action potentials, because a spike is much more standardized. I mean, it always sort of like from a, it has like intercellular, like the membrane potential signature of an action potential is quite standardized. And if you keep the if you keep the electrode position fixed, the extracellular shape is quite standardized also. However, with LFP, it's different because the LFP is typically generated by synaptic inputs into neurons. So, and then it, the recorded potential will depend very much on where this synapse is. For example, if the synapse is positioned at the apical dendrite on this pyramidal neuron, like in this case, then you get a negative. This is an excitatory current, so the current going into the neuron looks like this. This is for an excitatory synapse. Then close to the synapse, you get this negative shape, very close to the shape of this current. And far away, or like close to the soma, then you get this opposite shape. And this reflects a property of the cable actuation, which is used to model this, the dynamics of these neurons, is that current that goes in here must leave somewhere else. So in this case, the current that goes in here from the synapse is leaving through the dendrites, quite a bit of it out through this soma region. So that's why, and there the current has opposite sign, so you get this positive sign. So there's two things to say there. Right? One is that and if you have the synapse here instead, you get the opposite pattern. So for one thing, you can see that it's not very local in the sense that the synaptic input here gives a large signal down here. But also we see that the position of the synapse with this sort of a, when you vary the position of the synapse, the pattern can change completely. It sort of changes sign. So with many synaptic inputs, you can get all kinds of cancellation effects. So you can have a strong synaptic input, like many synapses onto the neuron that drives it to fire rapidly, but they can be placed such that the LFP that is set up is not very strong. And that is illustrated here on the next slide, where we have this 10,000 biophysically detailed neuron models. So this is called it's sort of like a stack of neurons, 10,000 of them. And this is not a very interesting network. These neurons are not internally connected, but they receive synaptic inputs from the outside. And then you can also measure, they have this electrode that going through the middle of this bush. And this where you can measure the local field potential. And what we see here, and this on the left illustrates where the synaptic inputs are. So first we can see now the synaptic inputs are all over the bush, and you see a very small local field potential. And then if it's all at the top, you get a negativity there, positivity here. And then when it's all at the bottom, we get the opposite. So we see that the LFP, the shape is like the positivity and negative switches place. And if it's evenly spread out, you don't see anything at all. This is on the right here, we see what you would measure at the same time with an EEG electrode. That's an electrode at put on the top of the head. So this is for the case where the population is radial, meaning that it's, so here's like illustrated, is a population of neurons, this red thing here, and the signal goes through all this, well, this cerebrospinal fluid and skull and scalp and everything, and this is what you measure on the top. And if it's instead it's like a tangentially oriented, then you get like a completely different pattern. So again, it's like the sign of the EEG and the signal very much, and the properties of it very much depend on directions. And here's the same thing with if you measure the magnetic field there instead. So this just illustrates that with any kind of neural model, in this case a very simple model with 10,000 neurons, you can sort of compute essentially all the signals. And for this, we have developed this tool LFPI, which I think is quite useful for if you want to do this kind of forward, what we call it, modeling of these signals based on your favorite model. So here's another example. So this is a network that was developed a few years ago by Potjans-Diesmann, and it's a it's a simplified model for a piece of cortex, 1 square millimeter, containing 80,000 neurons, and they are divided into like four layers, two neuronal populations in each, one excitatory, one inhibitory, and then in that case the synaptic connection rules were taken from experiments. But anyway, it's a model of a piece of cortex. However, this model here, the models are integrating fire neurons, and these are point neurons, so they don't have a spatial extension. And a point neuron, it's a single compartment, and single compartment neurons cannot generate extracellular potentials. So, but what you can do, because people are lots of models of are developed based on these point neurons, and they can certainly be very efficient and good for making network models that has a good, reasonable and a good, well, interesting spiking dynamics. But in order to compute also what you would measure in the local field potential, then you have to do this trick. And this is something we did a few years ago, where we actually did this trick where we first compute the spiking activity using NEST with point neurons, and then we store all the spikes and use them in combination with multi-compartmental neurons to compute the LFP in the second step. So it's like a two-step thing. You get the point neurons to get the spikes, and then you store the spikes, and you redo, in some sense, the simulation to compute the LFP, and now also the in this image here, this video here, also the EEG. The main point here, again, is to illustrate the principle, but you also see in this case, this network, visual cortex network, get an input at time 900, and we can see at that time, there's like this volley of activity spreading. We're coming back to it now. There you go. So you see that it's like a volley of activity spreading across the cortex following this input from the thalamus. And then we can see at the same time, we get this activity in LFP and also at the EEG. So what can you use this for? Well, I think a key thing is that if you want to, I mean, the traditional physics approach to doing natural science is to sort of, you formulate your hypothesis in a mathematical model, and then you sort of compute, well, take the, look at the, what are the consequences of this model, what kind of measurements would you do if this model was correct, and that sort of, and then you sort of compare with experiments, and then you sort of iterate back and forth until you have agreement between the model and experiments. Traditionally, I mean, this has not been pursued so much at the level of networks, and certainly not cortical networks. It's been difficult to make contact between sort of like a network model and specific experiments. And the attempts that has been has been making contact with experiments in terms of the spikes that is produced. And because that's sort of produced by all models produce spikes. However, a limitation, if you only compare with spikes, is that it's the spikes, you cannot measure spikes from many neurons at the same time. This is a limitation to how many neurons you can measure from. For example, with the state-of-the-art NeuroPixel probe, if you insert those through the cortex, you can maybe measure from, like, 70, 80 neurons. And if you have all these different populations, you end up with, say, if you have 10 populations or, 15 populations, you end up with like 5, 6, 7 neurons in each population. And these neurons are firing stochastically anyway. So it's not a very robust signal to compare with. The LFPs, on the other hand, gives inherently a measure of the population activity in neurons. So this could be a better way to constrain models to, in addition to comparing with spikes, also compare with LFPs. So this is something we're now working on in collaboration with friends and collaborators at the Allen Institute, particularly the groups of Anton Arkhipov and Christoph Koch, where we not only use their the model they produced or published like in 2020 with a state of the art in terms of large scale biologically detailed neural models. It has 250,000 neural models mimicking the mouse primary visual cortex. And they also have done a lot of recordings of spikes in LFPs in many, many mice using an almost like an industrial style approach where they've done the same kind of experiments on many, many mice. So this is what we're trying to do, essentially to try to make a model that can explain many of the experimental features that is measured, and not only a single feature. And so we like to call a multi-purpose purpose model. And here, so that's why, that's one of the reasons we, as a group, are interested in computing not only spikes, but also LFPs. So thank you for your attention.